Thank you for being open to learning about animal communication. I appreciate your interest in exploring this fascinating topic. I am here to help you begin rediscovering your ability to communicate telepathically with all of creation. It takes courage to step outside the norm and take action towards deepening your connections and understanding of other species, learning their language, which is also your own innate language. My goal is to help you begin rediscovering your own ability to communicate telepathically with all of creation. Telepathic communication is the foundation of all communication, whether between humans and humans as written or spoken language, between animals and animals, or humans and animals. It is the universal language, and all beings communicate at this level. We were born knowing how to communicate telepathically. This class is actually an exercise in remembering your own gifts. It is designed to teach you why being an effective listener is crucially important. Then I will give you 3 simple steps to communicating with your animals. I'm going to help you learn how to quickly and easily connect with them and give you the secret key to animal communication that every animal lover can use. Whether or not you go on to develop your skills and abilities, this is something you can use anytime. And if you apply yourself, you can enjoy a lifetime of deeper connections and magical heart bondings with animals. You can access their wisdom and seek their assistance in resolving your own problems. And I promise that if you continue with this, your life will change. In many ways, learning to communicate with animals is the first step in learning how to be a better human. I want to start out by sharing a story that Susan Chernick McElroy wrote in her remarkable book, Animals as Guides for the Soul. She spoke about how depressed she was one day, and she said it wasn't the normal kind of depression, but it was a protracted period of emotional deadness. She lived in the Pacific Northwest, where the gray winter made the shadow of depression seem even larger and darker. She said she felt just like the rain, saddened, shapeless, and splattering down. It was cold and wet, and that morning she couldn't find a reason to get out of bed, except that she had to tend to all the chickens, ducks, horses, donkeys, and the other animals that she had there at Bright Star Farms. While she fed each of the animals, she began reconnecting with the earth, the barn, and the beauty of the world. The kindness and the playfulness of each animal touched her heart and melted away the weight of her depression. And by the time she had finished showering her cockatoo pumpkin, the very last vestige of that depression was gone. She said that all she really needed was a good dose of enchantment, and her animal friends had obliged. Thomas Moore wrote an entire book on the value of enchantment called The Reenchantment of Everyday Life, and in that book he said that enchantment is a spell that comes over us in awe of fantasy and emotion that then settles on the heart. An enchanted life has many moments when the heart is overwhelmed by beauty and the imagination is electrified by some haunting quality in the world. By a spirit or a voice speaking from deep within a thing, a place, a person, or a being. The soul has an absolute unforgiving need for regular excursions into enchantment. It requires them like the body needs food and the mind needs thought. In her book, Susan said that animals are exceptional purveyors of enchantment and charm. When we are in the company of animals, we find ourselves transported out of the hectic world of modern human existence and into a luminous landscape of wonder and possibility. Animals help us find our deep connections to the earth. Susan said, "The fingerprint of God is often a paw print." Some people find their enchantment in music and art, dance, or religion. Others find it in nature or in animals. Animals bring us to the doorway of enchantment, and it does not require miracles or feats of great effort on their part. Why do you want to communicate with animals? Different folks have told me, because my animals matter to me. I want to be more aware of them and how they think. I love and admire animals. I think they understand us more than we understand them. They seem to have a wisdom that I wish they would share with me. And sometimes I feel that they want to tell me things, but I just can't seem to get it. I've also heard, "Animals are fascinating and I love hanging out with them. I want to better understand them so I can improve the quality of my relationship with them. I want to know what my animals need and what they want from me. How are they feeling? Is there something physically wrong? Can they help me in some way? I want to be closer to my animals and to connect at a deeper, richer level. If I could communicate with animals, it would add a whole extra dimension to my life." If your reasons for learning to communicate with animals are anything like these other folks, then you're in the right place. This course does all those things and more. This is important because animals live very long lives, and most folks do intend to give their animals a forever home. After all, our pets are often like our children. Millions of animals are adopted or purchased every year, and about 40% of them, a staggering number, wind up back in shelters where they might be given away again, put back on the street, or euthanized. Through no fault of their own, they simply weren't right for the job. They weren't a good fit for what was going on in that home, or they were misunderstood. No one took the time to communicate with them to find out what they truly needed or what the misunderstanding was really all about. When we have a problem with our animals, we often wind up doing a lot of expensive guesswork. We ask different professionals, we try different equipment or products, we use various tests and procedures to try to determine what's going on and what to do to help. And sometimes we get lucky and find answers that help, and other times we're actually no better off than when we started. We can even make things worse if we go in the wrong direction or try something that's not needed. One of the most valuable teleclasses I've done, which every animal owner should take, is the 10 serious mistakes animal owners make and how to avoid them. I find that most of the problems we have with our animals are due to these basic issues. The class is recorded and available, and it includes a special report. I encourage you to check it out. Animal communication has become more mainstream as more folks have become more aware of telepathic communication between humans and animals. Did you know that animals mirror us in mind, body, and spirit? Your homework assignment for this class was to take the Barometers of Our Souls teleclass, which explores the mysteries of the human-animal-body-mind connection. The assignment is designed to help you better understand who your animals really are and where the problems may actually be coming from. These problems may not have anything to do with your animal, even though your animal may be acting them out for you. It also gets into understanding and exploring what energies they are holding and mirroring for you, what lessons they're here to teach you, and all the many ways that they serve you. Animals are healers and spiritual teachers. In every relationship with an animal teacher, they're talking to us. Are we listening to them? Can we hear what they're trying to say? Most of the time, we're doing all the talking, and it gets very one-sided. We talk and think that they're supposed to listen to us. However, there has to be a time when we stop and listen to them. Many companion animals choose to spend their lives attempting to break through our limited barriers. They try to help us heal and become reconnected with all of life. That is why learning to communicate with our animals is so very important. As an example, a couple of years ago, I had a California client who was on disability leave, and she had pretty severe problems with her back and her neck. She had a young Briard dog, which looks kind of like a sheepdog. He was 2 years old, a little younger, maybe, and he had developed something very severe in his body, which looked like it was in his hips. He was weak. He couldn't stand or walk very well. He couldn't lift his head. He yelped in pain, and he couldn't run around and play. She took him to all kinds of different specialists, and they did all kinds of tests. She spent over $5,000 just trying to figure out what was wrong with her dog. Every professional she talked to had a different answer. One said they needed to do a total hip replacement on a 2-year-old dog. Another said that the dog had a rare disease. Since nobody would concur and nobody was helping, she didn't know what to do. Then she found me. Her daughter had seen an article of mine, and she referred me to her. And I worked with them, and we discovered that there was a cracked vertebrae in his neck and shoulder area. The dog told us when and how it had happened, and that the things being done to help him were not helping. Talking with him was what cracked the case. We asked the vets to x-ray the specific place, and they did in fact find a problem in those vertebrae. And not by coincidence, one of the woman's main problems was that she had a previously cracked vertebrae in her own neck in the same location. Now that we knew where the dog's problem was actually coming from, we had a chance to do something about it. When we worked with them, and I had to work with both of them in order to rebalance the issues between them, they both got better. We used a few different modalities, including the body talk system that I use with people and animals. We also broke the mirror between them so that he didn't have to reflect her dysfunction. I worked with them every 3 weeks for a couple of months, and she gave me a daily status report. It was absolutely a miracle from the first session. Within a week, he was jumping around, playing, and lifting his head again. He never required surgery. He recovered very quickly, which our animals typically do. They usually recover faster than humans. Within just a couple of months, her pain and dysfunction were lessened as well. If you did your Barometers of Our Souls teleclass homework, you learned that our animals often reflect back to us our own imbalances and dysfunctions. We think it's the animal's fault when what they're actually doing is mirroring something in us. They're acting as a teacher and a guide for our own soul and life lessons. Remember that our animals are like our children and are greatly affected by us, their caregivers. What we do, say, think, decide, and feel can rock their world or it can anchor it. The better balanced we are, the less stressed they will be. The more informed we are, the better prepared and able we'll be to communicate clearly and effectively with them, and the happier we all are. What if we could ask our animals what they need and want? How would that make a difference? I worked with a horse that had been considered dangerous, unpredictable, and difficult, even for advanced handlers. She turned out to be in pain, misunderstood, and injured. She is now in good health and is happily back in training again, and amazingly, she's working with a novice owner. The difference was that her new owner simply took the time to listen to and understand her, to learn what was wrong and what was needed, and then to give her what she really needed and wanted. And that was really all it took. And now the horse has done amazingly well.